Duperosy Duperas, what is going on, ladies and gentlemen? The Philadelphia season is underway, and it may have not started in the way we expected it to, but the good news is we walked away with some points. The bad news is it wasn't the 3 points that we all anticipated. And look, although it was a short offseason and we have most of our players coming back this season, the rust was definitely something we should have expected. And honestly, I didn't fully expect that. I thought that the uni would, for once, start off this season, you know, going full throttle on especially a club like Minnesota United. Now, Minnesota is still a really solid team, and I don't want to take anything away from Minnesota United, but we should have walked away here with 3 points. There were some mental mistakes. We didn't, like I said, we didn't start off with enough energy, and you're playing at home. You want this team to just go all out, balls to the wall, soccer, right? But unfortunately, it did not come to fruition, and we'll walk away with the point. And look, it's one of 34. There's no need to be panicking. We got a lot of soccer left. We're not even warm. We don't even have hot weather yet. So it's going to happen. It's going to get better, guys, and especially we saw Mikael Uhre before the game. We'll talk about that in a second as well. So it's only going to go up from here, ladies and gentlemen. It's only going to go up from here. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Union versus Minnesota United game recap. I'm your boy, Ed Parcero Philly, the owner of all things sports and culture here in the beautiful city of Philadelphia. Before we dive in, first off, thank you so much for everyone that is tuning on in, whether you're coming from YouTube, Twitter. We got TikTok in the building as well. Make sure, guys, if you're watching this live on YouTube, make sure you guys hit that like button. That would really mean the world for me. And, of course, if you are a Philly sports fan, consider joining the family by subscribing to the channel. We talk Philly sports all the damn time. So join the family. Never miss out. Make sure you guys also, if you are more of podcast listeners, which I agree with you as well, you can find these wherever you stream podcasts. You can find it under Owen Philly Sports. We always rebroadcast these in podcast form, so make sure you check that out. Make sure you guys follow on Twitter if you're coming in from Twitter as well. What's happening, guys? TikTok, what's going on? What's happening, TikTok? Welcome on in, guys. Make sure, again, thank you, first off, for hopping on in. We'll be doing something similar to what we did last night. In about 5 minutes, put the link in the chat here in the comment section. You guys are more than welcome to come on in. If you guys watch the Union game, you guys want to discuss it, you definitely can come on in and give me your thoughts on the Union as well. You guys can call on in. And, of course, TikTok, what's happening? Make sure you guys hit the like button and follow if you are a Philly sports fan. We talk all five Philly sports teams here on this account, so make sure you guys follow as well and join on in this family. What is happening, guys? Let's get it, guys. All right, so starting this off, obviously, we all know that heading into the season, there is a lot of emotions. There is high expectations. There are some feelings that may have trickled over from last year into this year. Look, the way last season ended wasn't in the way that we all wanted it to end. COVID kind of killed our season. We went against an NYCFC team that was hungry as well, as hungry as us, and COVID took it away from us. So now we put that in the past, and that's kind of what the point of what the hype video was for today. And thanks, shouts out to TikTok and Twitter and YouTube for showing love to that little hype. I love getting you guys hyped up, but we put that in the past, and in order to get to where we want to go, you sometimes got to fail. And last year, we failed by losing in Eastern Conference Finals. We got to take that emotion. We got to take it into this season, and we got to use it as a motivational tool. So I expected going into against Minnesota, you know, it was a pretty good crowd. It wasn't sold out, but I'd have to look at the final numbers. But I would say between 17 and 18, close to that, had to have been in the stands here in Subaru Park for this match. And I thought that the Uni would kind of feed off of that. But to start this off, really, it felt like Minnesota really seemed that the momentum heading into it. They had some better opportunities. They caught the Union a couple of times. They forced the back line into some mistakes. And if you guys watched the preview show, we discussed it. The last time we faced off against these guys, they tried to use that high press. They forced us into some turnovers. And in today, they kind of did the same thing as well, especially in the beginning parts of this first half. And it all kind of came to Minnesota's fruition when 22nd minute, you got Minnesota pressing us. And then you got a turnover by Olivier Mbaizo, let me just get through this play first, and then we'll discuss Olivier Mbaizo. Jeez Louise, Olivier Mbaizo gets forced the turnover, and I believe Reynoso was the one with the assist here for it was Fracopani. Fracopani really just overwhelmed Olivier Mbaizo throughout the whole 90 minutes, I would say. And Fracopani gets the turnover in our own zone, gets the ball. And then, of course, Olivier Bizzo's out of the play. So now you got Elliott Iglesias trying to move over. Lowe just goes right into the box unscathed, and he gets an open shot, and Andre Blake really couldn't do anything there. What I would say on that play, I don't understand why Kai Wagner didn't come up closer and try to at least chip block it in front of the ball, in front of Robin Lode. At least do something. Look, Olivier Bizzo, this is all Olivier Bizzo here. Franco Ponte really got the best of Olivier Bizzo throughout the whole 90 minutes here. And it's tough when, you know, essentially it's 3-on-2 because Olivier Bizzo was taken out of the play. But Kai Wagner should have definitely came up more and at least try to get in front of that ball. But regardless, it was what it was. You were down 1-0, 23 minutes in. And it wasn't the start that we anticipated. I mean, if you heard a lot of the predictions all throughout the league, a lot of people had the Union winning this game by at least a goal, two goals, a clean sheet for the Union. But Minnesota was not playing any games coming into Philly. So now, 12 minutes later, momentum, it was on Minnesota's side. But after that, the Union kind of woke up, and they really got after it at that point, and they really created some nice opportunities, and the momentum started shifting back over to the Union side. Jakob Glezis gets the ball out wide, and we really don't usually see Jakob out wide. And of course, with the new season and with Jakob Glezis back here, we got the return of the shoot. I love Union fans. And anytime he's going to get the ball now, it's going to be that. We're going to yell shoot. It's like watching a Flyers game, and it is so funny. But he got the ball out wide. He was able to cross the ball perfectly, and Corey Burke making a solid run into the box. And that got the Union up, that got scoreline tied up 1-1 with the Corey Burke header from Jakob Glezis's cross. And here we go. We got a 1-1 game here into this game. And now at halftime, it was a lot of good opportunities from both sides. And unfortunately, we could not get any more goals. And I just put the link in the chat if you guys want to come on in and let me know your thoughts on the Union game. You definitely come on in. And same thing with TikTok. If you guys watch the Union game, want to discuss what happened today for the Union, you guys should definitely come on in. YouTube link is in the bio. But we get into the second half, and the Union, kind of more of the same. I would say they played better in the second half than they did in the first overall. Because I felt like the first half was, you could break it down into two halves. I thought the first half of the first half, Minnesota looked better. In the second half, the Union did look better. But in the second half, I felt like the Union really got back to it. Did some great, you saw a little bit more of a high press as well. I will say this as well. It was tough to create some chances. The fullbacks didn't get up as high enough as we anticipated. And for a 4-4-2 diamond, which surprisingly enough, we saw that return again. The fullbacks needed to get up higher, and it was tough for Gazak to create those outlet passes. And unfortunately, we could not get any more goals in that second half. There were some opportunities, some nice subs as well by Jimmy Boy, but unfortunately for the Union, that was all that there was there. But I would say looked like a better team for most of this game. Unfortunately, they just could not walk away with 3 points. But let's look at those lineups real quick for the Philadelphia Union. Then we'll get to some of my takeaways overall from this game. We saw the return of the 4-4-2 diamond for the Philadelphia Union, and I was a little bit surprised for myself. I would have thought that Jim would have started off with the Christmas tree again, because obviously no Mikael Uhre, and that would be the expectation that Mikael would start up top with Julian Carranza. But instead, we saw the 4-4-2 diamond return with your usual suspects in the back five, obviously Andre Blake in goal, this usual back four with Kai Wagner, Jack Elliott, Jakob Glezis, Olivier Bizzo. Your midfield diamond, the same usual suspects again, Leon Flock at the left, El Brujo Martinez at the six, Ali Bedoya on the right, and Gazdak at the tip of the diamond, the number 10. And then your two forwards were Julian Carranza making his Union debut with Corey Burke up top. A little bit of a surprise there, like I mentioned. And, of course, the subs were pretty solid, and this bench is pretty deep when you watch it. Jack McGlynn comes in first for Leon Flock. A little bit of a surprise for me. I thought that Ed Brujo was going to get subbed out because number one, he got a yellow card, but then he blocked the shot that kept him down for a little bit. And I figured that he did look hurt, but this is Ed Brujo Martinez. We've seen this before, the little bit of the boy who cried wolf at times. But Leon got subbed out first. Jack McGlynn got put into the game the first touches, the first minutes for Jack McGlynn in 2022. And then you had Daniel Gazdak and Julian Carranza leave 10 minutes, or actually was 8 minutes later. Paxton Aronson comes in the game for Gazdak. And you had Sergio Santos making his union season debut. He comes off the bench, as we're probably going to see for the rest of the season. But I was also surprised that he took Carranza out instead of Burke. But hey, it was the terrible play, right? You got some solid forwards here, and Corey Burke got the goal. He deserved to play out there for 90 minutes. And a couple takeaways I wanted to say. To me, the best player on the pitch was Edbrujo Martinez through the whole 90 minutes. He brought the aggression, but he was literally all over the field today in a good way. Like he wasn't discombobulated, but he knew where he needed to be at times. Defensively, he did a great job of locking down guys. I thought he did a really good job of shutting down Reynoso for the most part. You're not going to always shut him down, but he was not getting by Edbrujo Martinez. And we kind of talked about that in the pregame, in the preview show. I expected that you need to go back to the Christmas tree, but you had the diamond, so that means that Brujo's going to probably be back more on his own more often in that type of formation. And that means a lot of one-on-ones with Reynoso, and I thought he did a really good job there. Minnesota in the first half really wanted to use a lot of those quick counterattacks to create a lot of turnovers, and they got those opportunities off those counterattacks. And the Union got a fair share as well. I mean, there was some good high pressing too, and they were doing a good job of counterattacking. It felt like the only type of offense this team could have created was off those counterattacks. And that's where it goes back to my point of those fullbacks. Kai Wagner and Olivier Baizo needed to get up higher in this game. They needed to create that width, because Minnesota just really went, they saw the Union going back on getting when the Union had possession of the ball, you just really saw Minnesota kind of sit back and just allow the Union to kind of try to attack within the central of the field. And when you got, you know, both your shuttlers, Leon and Ali, kind of cutting in, there's so much space out wide to kind of create from the outside. And we just did not take full advantage of that. The first half, there was a great opportunities from Edbrujo, from Olivier, from Jakob off that goal that we just mentioned. That has to be implemented more than the next game against Montreal, which we'll get to in a second as well. Olivier Baizo, to me, was the most disappointing player of the afternoon, and it breaks my heart. We talked about it at the end of last year. We talked about it yesterday in the preview show. This has to be a season for Olivier Baizo to just go out there and ball the F out. We know how last year ended. We know his defensive miscue in that final goal for Magno that secured the spot for NYCFC in the finals. He was a big part of that goal that happened. And he really played a bad game. A lot of turnovers in this game, a lot of bad, even in the attack, like I felt like he wasn't picking the right plays as well. He had a couple opportunities of crossing it in. But overall, in Baizo, look, he's going to have a short leash this year. You got a young homegrown Nathan Harrell who is literally right behind you, who wants that opportunity, wants to show what he has. And if Olivier continues to play like this, following what we saw last year, his ass will get benched. So he needs to improve upon that as well, guys. It was very disappointing to me. And we'll see what happens. But we talked about it on a Dupe by the River. We'll give it a couple game matches. But if he continues to be a detriment to this club or into this team, like how can you continue putting him out there? So we're going to have to wait and see what happens there. There was a lot of talk on Twitter about Alejandro Bedoya. And look, there's no secret. He's an old player. He's, 34 years old now. Like it's not the 26-year-old Ali Bedoya with the long lettuce going on his shirt, right? Just being that he was really quick back in his heyday, in his early days with the U.S. men's national team. But look, Alejandro Bedoya, you're not taking him off the pitch if he's healthy. You're going to start him if you have him in your 18. And what we need to remember is that Ali does a lot of the little things great, and he is that vocal leader on that pitch. When you're off on your game, there is an Alejandro Bedoya, your captain, who is willing to hold you accountable right on that pitch. He's a very smart player. He knows his game in and out. He knows where to be at all times, and you're just not going to bench Alejandro Bedoya. Now, I have been on record saying that I would like to see Alejandro Bedoya meet, maybe possibly being one of those first guys to come off the pitch. Now, I know that Ali is a very prideful man. We're Colombian. That's what we are. That's who we are. We're passionate, prideful people, and he doesn't always like to come off the pitch. But in order to conserve Alejandro Bedoya, I mean, we got guys on the bench. I mean, we could put Quinn Sullivan in here. I don't know about putting Jesus Bueno. I think Jesus could play as a shuttler because he's still got that he's got a little bit more of speed to be playing that position. But we have options on the bench that we could try to put there to give Ali a little bit of a rest. So to me, I'm benching him. I do agree we should maybe not like completely NBA load manage Alejandro Bedoya, but let's maybe monitor those minutes a little bit. And we'll see where that goes for sure. But as far as the homegrowns go, we saw obviously Jack and Paxton get in onto the pitch. Paxton had the last opportunity, which the officiating was a little questionable throughout the match. I do agree with that. There were some questionable calls. That final one, the call on Paxton Aaronson, and then they blow the whistle at the end. That really was a bummer as well. But I would like to see some more from Paxton Aaronson as well. So we'll see. But this overall, I think there was more negatives to take away than positives. There's not too many more, just a couple. It's a long season. We have 33 more matches to go into the regular season. Plus, you got Leagues Cup, you got US Open Cup. There's plenty of time for the unit to kind of fix these little quirks out, and it's gonna be okay. You still got Mikael Uhre. We saw him before the game, you know, getting the crowd, you know, all wound up and excited for game one. He gets into Philadelphia late last night. Finally gets his visa situation set up right before the start of the season. But if he would have came a little bit earlier, then possibly he could have played. But we got him right now, and that is the important part for sure. Awesome stuff, guys. What's going on? Let's get to some of these comments, and then we'll get, of course, guys, a reminder. If you guys would like, you guys are more than welcome on in and get in. We'll give you guys a couple minutes to come on and let us know how you guys are feeling about the game. As always, TikTok, you're more than welcome to come on in on YouTube as well, and you guys can call on in and let us know how you felt if you guys did watch the Union game here today. What's up, Gabe? What's happening? Appreciate you checking in on in. What's happening? AK Gaming checking in. What's going on? Pretty good game. Damn straight. Let's go. Let's get it. It's a good game. It was a solid game. It was a little sloppy, I would say, especially the first 45. It was a little sloppy, not my expectation. I know preseason's tough to get ready fully for this game, but it wasn't terrible. Hey, what's up, Dupesburg? What's happening? Not the result we expected. Glad to have the Uni back. Regard for Harold challenge for 2 minutes. Yeah, as we discussed during this, you know, Olivier Baizo not with the best performance of the match. But we'll see. You know, Jim is the type of guy, the type of manager that if you prove to him that you deserve to play during training throughout the week, you will get some minutes in the game, and Nathan's just going to have to push. I think Nathan could play. The thing is that Nathan and Olivier are kind of similar in the aspect that those guys know how to get up. Those guys know how to create, although I thought that Kai and Olivier could have done a better job of that today. But it's about getting back and playing defense and just not stepping in shit, essentially, in a lack of better terms. Just not finding yourself in bad situations. Obviously, the goal for Minnesota, Franco Pani pretty much had Olivier Baizo. Like, he has his number, even from last season and now this year. So we'll see. I hope that Nathan Harrell does push. I want everyone to get pushed. It's not just him. I definitely would like to see everyone getting pushed, especially a guy like Olivier Baizo for sure. All right, let's go backstage and let's start bringing on some people. We'll start off with my man, Ian Fitzmeyer.
Ian, what's going on?
Welcome to the Union Minnesota United recap. I'm good, man. How about yourself?
I'm doing good. I have no clue what's going on with the screen here. So
you're good, man. I trust you, Ian.
Yeah. I was actually going watching this in the flash. I'm going like looking back and forth because I have to stream it from the Union channel because I have Hulu. So they don't have like the PHL 17 channel, which is kind of annoying for me.
Hey, man.
Yeah. But so that was kind of fun. But when I was doing that, it was like, oh, that was really good. But then I was doing research ahead because I know what's going on in Europe because I put up in the comments section, in the private section. The MLS is, both MLS and NHL could be in some severe trouble if Ukrainian gets a lot worse, if countries start implementing drafts. So guys like Elliott, Gnees, Wagner, all the guys you see from like, Europe, main Europe. But there's some guys I'm trying to figure out, like Leon Flach. He has a dual citizenship here, but he was living in primarily Germany. I can figure that out. And there's even guys that don't make sense, like Freeze, McGlee, and Sullivan have dual citizenships, but they're also like born here in the U.S. So I'm trying to figure that stuff out as well. Because if it does get worse, the union have no choice but to let them go. And it's really sad because of the extradition treaties and stuff like that. It's completely messed up. And the only thing I've possibly heard is that Russia could be facing some bans for the World Cup if they're still in it. I still think they're still able to qualify for the World Cup, but they might lose that because of this. Gotcha. I'm sorry to bring it on to everyone that's kind of stuff that's heavy, but I might as well be upfront on it now so we get ahead of it.
Yeah. I mean, I've been vocal about it as well. I mean, for myself, the political side of this, it's not really something I want to dive into. Obviously, thoughts and prayers go out to all the citizens of Ukraine who have been going through this, who've been hurt by this. We've seen the impact of it worldwide. I'm not going to dive deep into what happens if there is a potential draft. I can't go there yet, but I think that for sure, you know, it's heavy hearts right now out there with Ukraine. And I saw a little bit of the Man City Everton pregame, two of the Ukrainian players on both sides hugging it out. And it's just a tough situation. And you know, hopefully we're going to keep them in our prayers, and we're just going to hope that the best does come out in the end with this for sure, man. But you know, let's get back to the pitch, Ian. Yeah. What did you think overall of this performance here? That's a tough 1-1 draw, man.
It is a tough 1-1 draw, and I would have liked to see we got to seize better on those opportunities, because when we were having them, especially like in the second half, I noticed we were having that momentum, but we were not finishing it. Again, I'm like, oh no. That was the one thing, like, why aren't we finishing it? Because we keep punching and punching and punching, but we're not getting that final nail through the coffin to end this game. Because honestly, I think we should have been up at least 3, maybe 4 on them the way they were up on that.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I agree. We had some great opportunities. I mean, Julian, Corey, Daniel Gazdag, even Leon had great opportunities in throughout this game. And look, I talked about it. Like, I didn't anticipate too much rust. There was more than I really thought. But, I mean, this is normal. Like, this is stuff that you should anticipate. I mean, game ones of any sport, it's really like that. You got to knock out that rust. So now you got game one underway. The tough part is you got a Montreal team who tomorrow are facing off against a tough Orlando squad. So they're going to be really prepared. Plus, they've been in Champions League. So when we face off against Montreal, that is going to be a really tough test to go up against. And the Union gonna have to figure this out, because if they play like this against Montreal, I don't think we get lucky and walk away with any points, but you got to be more clinical in the final third. And also, too, we could have Mikael Uhre ready for that game next weekend, so that should be some good news.
Yeah, and the other thing that I realized, because of our experience last year in the Champions League, how will Montreal adjust? Because if they're playing players in that short amount of time, who are they going to be benching in and out, and that's going to be tricky. Are they going to just do what Jim did? And it was kind of annoying that was like basically keep playing everyone over and over and over again. Mm-hmm. They do that early, it might come back to hurt them and help us, which I'm kind of hoping.
Yeah, absolutely. Ian, we're gonna move on here. I really appreciate you coming on in, Ian. You enjoy the rest of your afternoon, my man. Great listening to Ian there. And he brings up some good points, especially, you know, I thought that Jim, Jim this season has a lot of different type of cards in his pocket that he can play around with this year, from formations, different players that he can implement in as well. I mean, look at the subs. It was Sergio. It was Jack. It was Paxton. Those are three strong players that you can have coming into this match. To me, it's just all about knocking off the rust. We know that the talent is here for the Philadelphia Union. You got to go out there and play Union soccer. Jim mentioned that at halftime. They weren't playing Philadelphia Union soccer. They weren't playing physical, smart, disciplined soccer. And that's got to get approved upon, man. Dupesburg, the Rivers. It's a great time. I was missing. I won't lie to you. I was watching the game, and I was singing out. Cha la 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 la. It's a great time, man. You enjoy, man. Have fun with Sons of Ben and Keystone State Ultras, both great supporter groups, and can't wait for more from those guys. Thought my Martinez no red card take was going to be out at the win the first game. He was an absolute unit today. Dupesburg, he was the best player on the pitch, in my opinion, through the 90 minutes. Again, aggressive. He was everywhere. He was active on the attack, active on the counterattack as well. And, you know, when we got rid of Harris Madunian, this is why we got rid of him, because they had the eyes on El Brujo Martinez. He's a guy who has great defender, right? Obviously, Harris's holding play, being able to create the attack from that deep as a regista was really tough to take away. But this is the modern day era of the quote unquote regista. He's a great defender. He's able to get the ball, track back balls, and then create the attack from there, and or even from counterattacks as well. So expect some more play from Ed Bruno Martinez for sure going forward. What's up, King James Visuals? What's happening? Thanks so much for tuning on in. We see you out here. We appreciate it. So like I mentioned, next up for the Union, they're going to face off against Montreal, who, to me, I mean, if you guys listen to Duke by the River, make sure you guys do check that out every week. That is the Philly Sports Hour podcast for everything Philadelphia Union. Zach Labasso, my co-host, is a really big Montreal believer, and he believes that Montreal is going to be a solid team this year, and we will see what they can do. That's going to be next Saturday at 4 p.m. We'll face off against the Montreal Impact, and that will be in Subaru Park, if I'm not mistaken. I'm sorry, that's going to be in Montreal, and I believe we're going to be at the Olympic Stadium, ex-home of the Montreal Expos, for all my baseball people out there. So that's always a great time playing in that stadium. Nothing wrong with Saputo Stadium, but dude, the Olympique has got so much history, and it should be a lot of fun. But for now, guys, we're going to have to survive with this point here, and we're going to have to move forward and try to knock this rust off, and we're going to get some players. Mikael Uhre should be back by next week, and it's going to be all hunky-dory. It should be smiles from ear to ear, ladies and gentlemen. It's the excitement right now in Philadelphia. James Harden's debut last night. The Flyers get a big win, which, guys, if you guys are looking for the game recap, we're going to hop back in just a minute, and we're going to do our Flyers game recap. We're just going to close this out in just a second. Of course, the Union back here today. The result won it, but we got Philadelphia Union soccer back as well. So it's all great here in Philadelphia. Ladies and gentlemen, that's going to do it for today's Union game recap. Thank you so much for tuning on in. Really means the world to me. Again, the Union draw with Minnesota United 1-1 to start off the season. We'll be back at it next weekend, next Saturday the 5th. We'll be facing off against Montreal at 4 p.m. Ladies and gentlemen, make sure you guys hit that like button, subscribe to the channel for some more Philly sports content, and of course, make sure you guys subscribe to Oi and Philly Sports for all your podcast needs. I go by the name of El Parcero Philly. I'm telling you guys to dupe on. We'll talk to you guys next week.